Welcome. Bonjour à tous. For those of you who do not know me, I am Audra Dipti. I'm an associate professor in the Department of History and cross-appointed with the Institute of African Studies. Pour mes amis francophones et dans l'esprit de diversité, je vais parler un peu de français ce soir. Un peu, petit peu. Thank you all for taking time to be here with the Carleton University family as we celebrate Black History Month in 2017. C'est pas souvent que j'ai l'opportunité d'être à côté d'un intellectuel de la stature de professeur Horace Campbell. Il est un homme de lettres, un activiste, un intellectuel bien connu, bien célèbre. I'll leave it for others to say more about Professor Campbell's remarkable contributions. We'll hear much more about that in the next few minutes. But I do want to say a few words about 2017. 2017 is a year of significance for us here at Carleton University and in Canada more generally. 2017 marks the 75th anniversary of the year Carleton was founded. 2017 also marks the 150th year of the Confederation. These important historical markers aside, I might also suggest or argue that 2017 should be a year of reflection and contemplation. We're being witness to some very interesting times. The rise of anti-intellectualism, the upsurge of propaganda, fake news, alternative facts, the revival of a discourse of exclusion and hatred that harks back to an era when it was loudly proclaimed, never again. It is in moments like this that we are reminded about the importance of history, the power of history, and that for better or for worse, history can be used as a weapon. Black intellectuals have long fought to use history as a weapon as they countered the narratives of colonialism that celebrated the European civilizing mission. En 1950, c'était Aimé Césaire, l'intellectuel des Antilles, en fait de Martinique, qui a dit la colonisation travaille à déciviliser le colonisateur et à le dégrader. Or Stokely Carmichael, who in the 1960s, in his fight against a most virulent form of racism in the United States, who said, "Civilize yourself, white man." In other words, what I'm trying to say is that Black History Month provides us with an opportunity to reflect on those who fought hard to present alternative narratives, alternative historical interpretations, and alternative ways of understanding the world. Black History Month is also a moment when we celebrate diversity, or as they would say in Jamaica, out of many one people. Given that in 2017 marks 150 years since Confederation, the organizers thought it'd be a wonderful symbolic gesture, wonderful celebration of Canadian diversity if we had the Canadian National Anthem played on the steel pan. So I'll ask Dijahan to come up for a second. So for those of you that are unfamiliar with the instrument, the steel pan was invented in Trinidad and Tobago in the 1940s, but has become a pan-Caribbean instrument and an important part of the Caribbean-Canadian cultural tradition. A few words about the panist, the young man that's going to be playing for us. He attended Berklee College of Music on scholarship, recently graduated with his degree in music, and is doing quite well for himself. I'll ask you all to just stand as we listen to the Canadian National Anthem.
I can say that I'm standing on existing protocols. That's what we say in Nigeria when we don't want to repeat all the thanks and acknowledgments. But I can still say that on behalf of the Institute of African Studies community, I give you a very warm Carleton welcome to this event. The emphasis, of course, is on community. I did not say Institute of African Studies, is on community, because we are more than your regular academic department, academic unit in a university. It is true that we are the only one, we are peculiar. We are the only, and we like to brag about that. We are the only Institute of African Studies in the whole of Canada, in any Canadian university, in case you didn't know that. Yeah, so other universities may have centers, programs, minors, majors tucked away in obscure parts of there, but we are the only standalone. But coming to why we are here this evening, first I must say that I'm extremely proud, you know, of what my sister and my partner in crime, Audra, you know, because when we did this thing last year, we took a leap of faith, you know, asking you to come here to this huge room. But when we did this thing last year, we made quite a splash and we surprised ourselves. And I told Audra and June, I said, oh, you are in trouble. You have started something and now we have no choice but to grow it, develop it, and make sure it's come to stay. And so I'm very, very happy that our gamble or our leap of faith has paid off. And we practically have almost double the crowd that we had last year. So that's a testament to the kind of the sense of community and your continued support for the work that we are doing as a unit in the community. Now, if I may quickly say something about why our theme this evening and the person, our guest who has come to speak to that theme, has a particular resonance for me, the theme, the international solidarity aspect of the theme, it is because, as Audra has said, we are in perilous times when the very basis of solidarity, you know, the very basis of certain forms of solidarity, whether we are organizing solidarity and actions, you know, of agency on the basis of identity, you know, identity, race, shared historical values, you know, the very question of solidarity is under assault. It's under assault because there is this euphemism that the post-truth moment and the post-factual moment have vanquished the moment or the era of identity politics. And what I hear when people criticize identity, and I've been seeing it in the global media, oh, you know, the end of identity politics. You know, and I see even in New York Times, I see question marks being placed on identity politics and the elements or the branches or the aspects which feed identity politics. And so just yesterday, I was having a conversation, an email conversation about this with a friend of mine, a colleague, who happens to be an evangelical Christian on the right. Across the border, and he was critiquing identity politics, by which, of course, the understanding is historical forms of othered, excluded identities. You know, oh, you know, that's not the moment for you guys. And I told him that, my friend, you know, I'm wondering if the critique of identity politics and whatever you are using it to euphemize should be coming from a Christian. And he says, Pius, what do you mean? I said, yeah, it is true. We are in a very, very, very difficult moment with identity politics now, or whatever you mean by it. But I'm thinking that our situation is almost like the situation of somebody I know who, like me, experienced colonial oppression. So he was a colonial subject of empire. He was a colonized native under empire. And he understood the need to mobilize his identity, you know, at very peculiar moments in his own history, you know. I may be an ex-colonial subject of the British Empire, but the person I'm talking about was also a colonized native in Judea, you know, lived in Nazareth, and was under the tutelage of the Roman Empire. And at some point in his life, he did ask the question, who do people say I am? And they said, some call you this, some call you that, some do this, some, but you, what about you? Who do you say I am? So this colonized spiritual and political figure understood the meaning of identity. I said, that's, you know, if it happened 2,000 years ago, why should attempts in our contemporary era, you know, to mobilize identity as a form of solidarity come under this question? So I am hoping that the assault on solidarity, that the fear of solidarity, the question mark on solidarity that we are witnessing in our times, that I will find a basis for a continuous belief in it as a valid way forward, you know, for Black people, for oppressed people, for all people in needs of all kinds of alliances and solidarity. And on that note, so I hope I would find answers in some of the interesting conversations that we are going to have, certainly have this evening. And on that note, I'm going to yield this space, because I don't want to be the lecturer, to my president. Audra played a fast one on me by asking me to introduce the president of Carleton University. And I don't know if I want to introduce her as the president of Carleton University. I have nothing written, so I'm not going to embarrass you. But that's all I'm going to say is, we are what we are at the Institute of African Studies. We have come this far largely because of her support. Everything we do, all our events, she's always there. So she's got our back, and we see her, we call on her, and she comes. And so we don't quite think of her as, you know, the president when we think of Dr. Roseanne Runty. We think of her as the number one honorary citizen of the African Studies community. And it's that hat that I hope she would wear when she comes to talk, give us a few words. Et puis, à nos amis francophones, elle m'a un peu pris de court. Elle m'a un peu pris de court parce que, bon, mon français, bon, soyez les bienvenus.
Et quel plaisir vous voir tous ici ce soir, une soirée du printemps au milieu de l'hiver. And what a great evening to celebrate and begin our celebrations of Black History Month, then an evening of warmth and sunshine. And there are times when people say to me, you know, it's the same sun that shines over all people of the world, and it warms us all. But there are days in the winter when I wonder about that, because I don't think I got the small part of that sun. And so today I really feel that it reminds us that we are all one under the sun. And when we start talking at Carleton, we usually say that we're standing on traditional grounds of the Algonquin people. And that is a lovely thing to say, but it is also something that causes us to think about who we are. Because when we think about the pasts of nations, we think about the history, and the history is something that we write and we create. It's the stories that we tell. And we can tell the story of colonization and put ourselves separate from it and say that was some other past that didn't belong to me, wasn't my generation. And yet, aren't we all sons and daughters of people who have colonized the earth? And aren't we all responsible to create a better world? And when we talk about Black History Month, we're talking about recognizing an important history and in writing that history and making the culture and art and the celebration of it known to the world. And it's something that we can do at the university. Canada is 150 years old this year. Carleton is 75. We're very young. We're half as old as Canada. Wonderful. However old Canada will be, Carleton will always be young. It's a secret of youth. And yet, it's also the task of the youth to remind the old of its history and to help the old create a better history. And when it's our 75th anniversary, we shouldn't just think about the great things that we've done. We have to think of all the things that remain to be done, the fields that need to be discovered, the knowledge that needs to be uncovered, the truths that need to be shared, the false facts that need to be buried. And yes, we need to come together in evenings like today and this evening to discover the great intelligence and experience and wisdom of our neighbors to the south who were wise enough to steal our speaker from Toronto. How could that happen? In other words, Carleton is really glad to bring you back to Canada, sir. And we are so privileged to have you here. And Carleton, when it was founded as part of a community. And bringing that community together, whether it's across boundaries, across disciplines, across centuries and continents, is something that we do really well at Carleton. So welcome to the international, intercultural future of Canada. Thank you.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to this event, Popular Resistance in Africa and International Solidarity. The first time I encountered Horace Campbell, I was about 6 or 7 years old. I was reading, my parents used to be columnists for what was in the 70s the main black newspaper in Canada. It was called Contrast. And Contrast was really a pioneering newspaper. It was published by this maverick from Edmonton, Alberta, by the name of Al Hamilton. And it's only now, about 40 years later, that I realized that Al Hamilton was a Pan-Africanist. And that was certainly evident in reading Contrast. Horace Campbell was a regular contributor to Contrast. And as a 6 or 7 year old living here in Nepean, because my parents were columnists for the newspapers, I would actually try to read the newspaper. And I would come across all these names that at the time probably didn't mean as much to me. But it's only now that I kind of realized the significance of it, because Horace was in that newspaper. People like Walter Rodney, Morris Bishop. It was a paper that would cover people like Robert Sobukwe from the PAC in South Africa. It was a newspaper that would cover people like Angela Davis, Stephen Biko, Samora Michelle. It was a paper that really brought the world to Canada and certainly reflected that world on a weekly basis. And Horace Campbell played a very prominent part in that newspaper. The next time I met Horace Campbell was about 19 years ago. In the late 1990s, I was working, I was managing the McGill radio station. And I was part of a grouping that invited Tajuddin Abdul Rahim, who was the Secretary General of the Pan-Africanist Congress, and also Horace, to Montreal. And I don't know how it happened, but Horace and Tajuddin ended up bunking at my house. We ended up having a long conversation into the wee hours of the morning, and Horace ended up sleeping over. And I think he ended up sleeping over for 2 nights. Didn't pay anything. He didn't pay anything, but he certainly enjoyed my breakfast and bed as well. It's always dangerous to renew acquaintances with old friends because they sometimes tell the truth. When I met Horace this evening, he said, "Adrian, you look different." And I said, "Horace, you look the same." And I said, he said, "You put on weight." And I said, "Well, I have 2 kids and I'm 46. So once again, Horace was telling the truth. But the reason I mentioned Contrast is that Horace Campbell is someone who has stayed true to his roots. He has not wavered in the 40 years since the time that he was very active in Toronto circles and certainly active in Contrast. You know, just to kind of give you a sense of what Contrast was about, it was a publication that was committed to making social change. It was committed to speaking truth to power, asking difficult questions. Contrast called for a boycott of South Africa, refused advertising from firms that did business with a racist regime, and urged artists to not perform there. Contrast was a beacon, a source of strength for what was then an often beleaguered black community in this country, a community that was too often dismissed and ignored, a community that was regarded as troublesome and defiant, a community that refused to heal. And Contrast was a publication that stuck to its guns. And Horace Campbell is certainly stuck to his guns. Horace Campbell is a professor of African American Studies and Political Science at Syracuse University. In 2016-2017, he was given the prestigious appointment of Kwame Nkrumah Chair in African Studies at the University of Ghana. He's well known in his dual role as both an academic and activist. He has published extensively on a range of topics related to the comparative politics of Africa and the Caribbean. The first publication that I read of Horace's was as an undergrad at McGill, and the book that all of us had to read at the time was Rasta and Resistance. It was a book that all of us were passing around, and it was like gold at that time. It actually looked like gold, too. If I remember, I think it was yellow. I think the front page was yellow, if I remember correctly. His publications include Global NATO and the Catastrophic Failure in Libya, Barack Obama and 21st Century Politics, Pan-Africanism, Pan-Africanists, and African Liberation in the 21st Century, and also Reclaiming Zimbabwe. Without further ado, give a very warm Carleton welcome to Professor Horace Campbell.
What can I say about that kind of introduction? Because someone is introducing you who knows you. So, and not only that, Adrian, I understand that you've become very successful. Oh, as a
that's news to me.
Public person in the media. I'm looking around and I want to say thanks to all of you for coming out. I want to say thanks to the university for organizing another Black History Month. And I hope that our job is to make sure that we don't have History Month, Black History Month in the university. The time should come when we do not need Black History Month. And I am one of those working to abolish Black History Month because we need the time when the history of humanity is so central to the curriculum that Black History Month is the everyday of every year, so we don't need a special month for it. I was contacted by Audra in late November, and she asked me if I would come to speak here. And I said, well, it may be difficult because I'm not in Syracuse. She probably thought I was in Syracuse. But she persisted. And with her entrepreneurial skills and dedication, she said, OK, we're going to get you here because we want to have you come to speak for Black History Month. So I want to thank you for your tenacity and to say that what you're about is right on target in terms of the kind of world that we're fighting for. She did tell me that the university was supportive, and I can see that support manifest in the presence of the president. It's not usual that presidents of university take their time out on Saturday afternoon to attend functions such as this one. And for me, what is impressive is what you say, because I always start my talks in Canada, the United States, in that way, that whatever we're doing, we must recognize that we're on the grounds of the First Nation peoples, and that our work here is to recognize what they've done before us. And I want to thank you for your support for this event and for your presence, and I'm hoping that you will work with us to ensure that Black history, African history, becomes a part, full time, all the time, of the curriculum in the university, and it's not just one time. the chairperson of African Studies. Is that what you call it? Director of African Studies. That's a big title. It's a big title. You don't know how much responsibility you're taking with that title. Because African Studies is really crossed a very big turning point in terms of working with the peoples of Africa, especially global Africa, in meeting the needs of our time. And the president already referred to that time, and you yourself referred to that time. I do want to thank the Institute of African Studies, and I've asked your colleague in the Global Studies Institute that we are hoping that your institute would become a central pillar in the Kwame Nkrumah Cultural and Intellectual Festival, which we are going to have in Ghana, June 26th to July 1st. As I've said, I was installed last week as the Kwame Nkrumah Chair at the University of Ghana. And the mandate that I have for that chair is to propagate the ideas of Kwame Nkrumah and to propagate the ideas of African Union and African unity. So I spoke to at great length this morning with Professor Clark, and I'm asking that all of you work in your communities. And I spoke to a diplomat last night who came from Ghana to bring me in out of the cold. And I was asking that this would be one of the centers to support the Kwame Nkrumah Chair and the Cultural and Intellectual Festival. And I hope your university will be able to do that. To my partner and comrade who came up from Syracuse, I want to thank you. She and I, we've been in this thing for a long time. And we want to spend as much time as we can. Now, the diplomats, this is good that they're here, because the African diplomatic community, the Caribbean diplomatic community, and I understand the ambassador from Barbados, ambassador from Jamaica, have come out tonight. And that is of special importance to me, because I've just come from Havana. I went to Havana, I came yesterday, because I went to the International Book Fair in Havana. And this is such a phenomenal event that here is in Camden, an old fort, the book fair, 200,000 persons go through that book fair every day. So here it is, what was a military structure before in Cuba, the Cuban people, the Cuban government, have turned it into a place for learning and knowledge. And so the Cubans are saying, our best defense for our revolution is through an educated population. And I think that is a statement. In fact, I was speaking to one of my very close friends this morning that we work with, and we said one of the things we should start in the United States is a major literacy campaign, because the people in the United States need to know the extent to which they needed to become literate. I hope I have thanked everybody, because I don't like to do what is done in Africa to say all protocols observed, because, yes. So I want to thank especially those who came out this evening. I went to Cuba to launch this book called Rasta and Resistance, written 35 years ago. And the Cuban people and government decided to translate that book into Spanish and to make it available, and it's being sold for $1 equivalent in Cuba to the Cuban people. That's how seriously they take the, and I brought three of the Spanish version, and I'm looking for someone to translate it in French here, and to translate, no, it is translated in French, but to translate my global NATO book. But that book, Rastan Resistance, was the book where I wanted to deal with the question of anti-colonial struggles and the consciousness of the Caribbean peoples, especially the people of Jamaica, in the attempt to redefine their humanity, and how the Rastafari movement, in resisting colonialism, resisting the British Empire, identified with an African monarch. And so I dealt with the dialectic of that situation of rejecting one monarch and identifying with another monarch. But what's important about that statement in that book was the attempt in that book to deal with a kind of resistance that came from below, that came from the grassroots. And my point in that book was that the very process of resisting against an imperial system and putting forth another emperor held within that seeds of contradictions that will hold back the movement. And what would put the movement forward would be the extent to which it is rooted in the working people and the extent to which that movement would go along with the challenges of the working people. I think the book has done its work, and the question of the Rastafari, we can now see that that movement is part of the transformation of humanity, because the main philosophy of the Rastafari movement, the main philosophy, peace and love, is something that will be there through the ages. And if you know the theme song of the Rastafari movement, one love, one heart, let's get together and be all right, it's about Ubuntu. So at the philosophical level, it has made a major contribution to the world. And so the Rastafari movement is not a Jamaican and Caribbean movement, it's a world movement. So in the topic for tonight, I wanted to reference the current resistance in Africa and why that resistance in Africa is calling for global solidarity, and why that resistance in Africa at another period called on human beings in every part of the world to support the African peoples. In particular, we remember the resistance to apartheid. And in those days, the resistance to apartheid built a popular international movement that embraced all classes, all peoples in every part of the world. And the anti-apartheid movement put forward two propositions that the university has not caught up with yet. The first proposition was the proposition of creating a non-racial democracy. The second proposition was to articulate a philosophy called Ubuntu, and how that Ubuntu would be the theoretical basis for organizing society and the relationship between humans and nature. In South Africa, of course, we have seen that international capital, because of the success of the anti-apartheid movement, moved aggressively after the defeat of the most overt forms of apartheid. And actually, the foundation spent $1 billion through foundations and corporations and governments to change the discourse in South Africa. So now in South Africa, they don't talk about non-racial democracy so much. They talk about democracy, governance, human rights, development, and all of those terms that are used to depoliticize the African peoples. But the conditions in South Africa are so dire for the majority of the producing peoples that the resistance continues. And so the intellectual in Africa is forced to deal with how do we transform the conditions of the peoples of Africa. And so we are at the point where the transformation of the conditions of reproduction of life is at the forefront of the agenda. And so my term as the Kwame Nkrumah chair, I hope to articulate questions of reconstruction and transformation. So the question of resistance in South Africa has brought to the forefront the role of the university and the academy in meeting the needs of ordinary Africans. Because clearly, 23 years at the end of apartheid, we can say for a large section of the South African peoples, the conditions are worse. And the academics don't have much to gloat about, because in resistance literature, we have, I wrote this book, Rest and Resistance, and then it came out, and I start from what I call the emancipatory intellectual framework. And of course, my theoretician is someone who didn't come out of the university. My theoretician is someone called Bob Marley, emancipate yourself from mental slavery. None but ourselves can free our minds. So that emancipatory framework that we're trying to develop intellectually has been countered by what is called in the academy postmodernism. And one of the main theoreticians for this was someone called James Cott, who wrote a book called Weapons of the Weak, about resistance in Asia. And what that kind of work did is to deal with resistance and to cut resistance off from the conditions in which people find themselves. And in this case, he was an anthropologist dealing with peoples in East Asia. So the question about resistance, we're not celebrating resistance because if you go on the web, and I wrote a very long article about popular resistance in Tanzania 30 years ago now. And I was telling the Tanzanian government then that the way you handle this popular uprising is the way in which you ensure that you have stability in your country. Because if you do not, others will come in and mobilize them against you, which is what the French have been doing all over Africa to create real problems in Africa. So we're at a conjuncture where you in the university, 75 years after the independence of Canada, need to say whether you're in solidarity with people in Africa who want independence and who want to end colonialism. So this conjuncture we're in, what is it? Where are we going with this resistance? Now last year, Christine Lagarde, who is the managing director of the International Monetary Fund, she said, we're at a 1914 moment. That was a very profound statement coming from the head of the IMF. What was the 1914 moment? What happened after 1914? Well, let me remind you. 1914 was 1 year after the pound crashed, and the British pound was no longer the dominant international currency after 1913, and the US government set up the Federal Reserve. And from 1913 to 1944, we had a transition from the pound to the dollar, where we have international insecurity at the financial level and financial war, trade wars, and international currency wars. That was what happened in the 1914 moment. And out of that 1914 moment, we had a number of catastrophes. The first one was this war where British workers fought against German workers, and it was repeated 30 years later, where British and German workers fought. So when we talk about this conjuncture, and we want to resist the forms of economic organization and people, we have to reflect deeply on what we want to come out of this. And so what I want to appeal to you tonight is about the fragility of the moment in which we live. A professor in California called Jack Rasmus wrote a book called Fragility of the International System. It's an excellent book, but the only problem with this book by Jack Rasmus is that he does mention Africa in it. He talks about fragility and talks about the nature of the international capitalist crisis and about dueling quantitative easing. So for us, this fragility has four implications. The first implication of this fragility, the social consequences. The social consequences in relationship to the hierarchies that comes out of privatization, financialization, and militarization. I call it in my work the military management of the international system. And this concentration and centralization in financialization that we've seen is having consequences in economies all over the world, but particularly in Africa. But in Africa, they have some experience, because what is new in the fragility has been visited on Africa for more than 30 years through what is called structural adjustment policies. So the African people have been through this moment. But now that moment is here in North America and Western Europe. And we've seen the consequences. So that's one of the first elements of the fragility, as I understand it. The second element of the fragility is the polarization in class terms. And in that polarization in class terms, you have it on the international level, where the Africans are more and more exploited. In the literature, they call it the global value chain. Now Africa is plundered in the global value chain. So the social consequences are that we come to something that is called inequality. And there's a man called Thomas Piketty who has written a book about this thing called inequality and capital in the 21st century. But again, Africa is not there. So it is you who have to put Africa at the center of this story. So the social conditions, implications of inequality and exploitation at the international level. The third element of fragility is the conditions of the global working people. As I said, in Africa, the workers of South Africa, the workers of Nigeria, all across Africa, the working people are struggling just to recognize their day-to-day life. But all of a sudden, the working peoples in Britain, France, Belgium, Spain, the United States are awakening to the fact that this inequality and this dream of America is not helping them. And so they are reacting the way they've been taught, that they must react to ideas about white supremacy, about xenophobia, and then against people who are not white. The whole eugenics question comes back with the consequences we are seeing in Europe and the rise of Marie Le Pen. Whether she becomes president or not in France, what is important is that her ideas are polluting. France, which was the cradle of liberty, humanity, and fraternity, is now the basis for the deepest xenophobia, racism, and Islamophobia. And that Islamophobia is very dangerous in the United States of America, because it is fueling a kind of radical Christian fundamentalism, and that radical Christian fundamentalism wants to resolve the international crisis through war. Which brings us to the rise of the current administration in the United States of America. But we'd be making a great mistake if we individualize the question of the presidency of the United States, and to separate the person of the President of the United States of America from this fragility of the capitalist system. So, the fragility of this system, the big danger for me is that they will seek to resolve this crisis through war. Now, this is where I would expect you in African studies, you in the university, to take your responsibility serious. I dropped everything I was doing to write this book, Global NATO and the Catastrophic Failure in Libya, Lessons for African Unity. Why? Because I wrote this book because I remember 1935. When the Italian invasion of Abyssinia took place in 1935, the Rastafari, the international African movement says, Europe, this is war that is coming. Europe said, no, this is just a little dictator in Africa that's been overthrown. Africa says, no, this is based on this economic crisis, trade war, financial warfare. And in 1936, we saw in Spain the rise of Franco. And in 1937, we saw the Japanese invasion of China and the genocide in Nanjing. And in 1939, we saw the rise of Hitler. Are we resolving the crisis in the same way? Are we sleepwalking into a similar crisis? Canada and Canadians joined in this charade called responsibility to protect, where the country of Libya has been destroyed. And since my book was written, we now have the emails from Nicolas Sarkozy to Hillary Clinton on the five reasons why they want to go into capture and destroy Libya. And the five reasons were, we have to save the euro. We have to save Europe. That Europe and its future rests on controlling African resources. So here it is. The international community, the so-called community, has this thing called responsibility to protect. They go into Libya and they finance groups that they themselves call terrorists to overthrow an African government. And 6 years later, they're still there. And behold, there's a judgment that was being going through the High Court in England over Goldman Sachs' dalliance of $5 billion of Libyan money. And behold, when this matter was going through the court in England, behold, in 2014, there was a new war in Libya. And behold, the case was thrown out because the Libyan Investment Authority no longer exists because the forces that were being supported by the Goldman Sachs and the West ensure that the Libyans have no government. Where is the university in all this? Adrian mentioned the fact that 40 years ago, when we were in university in Toronto, 40 years ago, Pierre Elliott Trudeau was the prime minister of this country. But Pierre Elliott Trudeau took a position against the war in Vietnam. He did not go along with Richard Nixon and the war in Vietnam. He took a position against the apartheid government. And he took a position of supporting Cuba. By the way, the book fair this year was dedicated to the relationship between Cuba and Canada. But why did Trudeau take those positions? Trudeau took those positions because the university, the community, the trade unions had taken a position against the war in Vietnam. What is the position of the university today about ISIS and fighting terrorism? Where is the university research? So I am challenging my colleagues in the university and in the community in Canada that you must hold the Canadian leadership to their feet so that they are not supporting the United States Africa Command in this so-called war against terror in Africa, because the war against terror is a business to ensure that the United States remain in Africa. In fact, 2 days ago, Mr. Whitaker says, we should make America great again in Africa. So there you have it. What is the response of African studies, the community, the media to this? Let me just wrap up so we can get into the conversation. We have a new stage of resistance in Africa. In South Africa, in Ethiopia, the Ethiopian resistance has reached a very definite stage. In the Ethiopian resistance, it has now been internationalized through the Olympics. But the limitations of this resistance is the extent to which there is not a Pan-African project in the resistance, because the oppression of the Oromo people in Ethiopia, the resistance is represented in terms of Oromo nationalism. And in Pan-Africanists, we cannot support any form of nationalism of that sort. We did it in Eritrea, we did it in South Sudan, but our project is 2063 United Africa. We want self-determination for the Oromo people in Africa, in the reconstituted Ethiopia, but of course, there won't be any Ethiopia, just like there won't be any Kenya, there won't be any Nigeria. We're just going to have one government. That's what we're working for in 2063. That's what Agenda 2063 is. But in the interim, we must work with the people from Oromia so that we do not create refugees from Ethiopia. And we should prevail on the Ethiopian state in its present form, that the trafficking that goes on from Ethiopia in the bodies of African women who work as servants in Saudi Arabia, that especially you in the university here, you should be raising your voices about that. The other resistance that is ongoing in Africa, and the major resistance, is that of our brothers and sisters in Egypt. And that resistance have the basis for really overturning everything in Africa, because that Egyptian process brought so much that was new to Africa. And I hope we can discuss that some more in the discussion. But some people think the Egyptian revolution is over. And I'm suggesting that the structural conditions in Egypt, that gave rise to the resistance has not changed. So if the structural conditions have not changed, then we are going to continue to need organizing and solidarity with the Egyptian people. This is about Nigeria. This actually is probably one of the most fascinating places where the resistance is developing in Africa. And Nigeria, the Nigerian working peoples have been most tenacious in ensuring that Nigeria hangs together in spite of regional differences. In the north, we have something called Boko Haram. I don't know what that is. It's some young people who say, we are going to sell women in the marketplace. It's as if they didn't know about the relationship between black people and slavery. That they could even get on television and say that. But the Nigerian working people have been very successful so far in holding that society together, because the machinations of France, the United States, the European Union for breaking up Nigeria is ferocious. The challenge for us is to ensure that we go beyond that narrative in Nigeria that deals with ethnicity, that deals with religion. Then we have the Democratic Republic of the Congo, which is the resistance that you really need to identify with, because they're calling on you to say, when you buy your cell phone and when you purchase your cell phone, you should think of the conditions under which coltan is produced. And they're asking you to rise above the way in which they speak about the people of the DRC. The last resistance I want to refer to that is noteworthy in Africa are very successful. This is the resistance of the Burkinabe people, because it tells you when the people have a good tradition and what Sankara has done in mobilizing for the Pan-African Festival. I went to Burkina Faso and we are getting about 50 young people, and it took me to the place where the people walked about 10 kilometers from one part of the city to another to drive the president out of town. So the traditions of Thomas Sankara are alive. But you don't hear about these success stories of the Burkinabe people and the kind of democracy that they're fighting for in Burkina Faso. And that kind of democracy they're fighting for in Burkina Faso. They're at the forefront of fighting for environmental justice and to reclaim Africa from the Sahel. The last point I want to make is with respect to the quality of lives of the African people. The quality of the lives of the African people depends on changing the social system. This social system has never met the needs of the lives of Africans. And Black History Month is another moment to discuss reparations. Black Lives Matter put forward 6 points. The Black Lives Matter last year took a position in the African liberation movement, and they put forward a sixth time to say, yes, we are human beings. You must invest in black life. You must end militarization of the planet. And at the foundation of this is a question of reparations. Now, in 2001, we met in Durban. And when we met in Durban in 2001, we put out an agenda for dealing with slavery constituted a crime against humanity. 16 years later, the university as a whole is afraid of this agenda. And whether they like it or not, whether it is Yale University and Calhoun House, whether it is the Georgetown University and the amount of money that was made from slavery, or Brown University, the university is caught up in its content, what it teaches, in the history of super exploitation of Africans. I'm going to sit down in a minute so we can talk, but I want to recommend a book for you by Edwin Baptiste, The Half Has Never Been Told. It's really about the kind of brutalization that went on against African peoples and why reparative education should be at the forefront. In the United States of America, all of the liberal intelligentsia that have been quiet about the prison industrial complex, about the educational system, about the plunder of Africa, they are not up in arms over the kind of government that they have. But that government, we are not resisting and opposing that government because of their racism. That government is a direct consequence of dueling quantitative easing. I don't know if many of you heard about quantitative easing, but really, it's about the United States printing money. And so we are at that moment in Africa, in the world, where the university, the community, must get back to that moment where we recognize the value of all human lives, and where the university should be in the forefront of saving the planet Earth. And saving the planet Earth is not about being black or white. It's about our common future. Let me stop there so we can continue the conversation.
I wanted to begin by addressing something that you talked about towards the end of your presentation, and that is changing the social system within Africa. Because I'm interested in what African liberation means in an age of climate change, an age of coming artificial intelligence, in an age of the digital economy, in the age of Al-Qaeda in the Maghreb, in the age of Donald Trump. So what does African liberation actually look like, and what kind of social system do you think needs to be implemented?
That's a lot in one question. African liberation and climate change. What was the second one?
Well, I said African liberation in the age of artificial intelligence.
Artificial intelligence.
In the age of the digital economy. Like, what does, I guess, just to be clear, like, what is African liberation? What does it mean in 2017 to you?
Yeah. I'm glad you asked that question. Because that's the project I've assigned myself. My project as the Kwame Nkrumah chair is to deal with the reconstruction and transformation of Africa. And in my view, the fundamental question for the 21st century and African liberation is that Africans are human beings. That's it. That's what African liberation means. Let me elaborate. In the era of artificial intelligence, in the era of transhumans, in the era when humanity is going to break out into two, one of the things that is being done by bioanthropologists is to go into African villages to tap into the cognitive skills of Africans, because in order to program the robots for the 21st century, they found that the cognitive skills of Africans are the most advanced. So we have the convergence of information technology, nanotechnology, biotechnology, and cognitive technologies, which push artificial intelligence. And they are going into Africa because the African languages, which holds the secret of humanity, has the answer. So there is something called the Human Cognome Project that IBM is financing to go into African villages to study these things. Our work is, how do we harness those resources from Africa for bettering the conditions of the life of the African people?
I guess my question is...
Well, let me finish.
But I'm gonna maybe sharpen the question a little bit.
Yeah.
Because artificial intelligence is, we know that it's going to create a crisis
in
the North American economy.
Yes.
We know that a lot of people depend on jobs like truckers.
Yes.
They're gonna be losing their jobs.
Yeah.
What is it gonna mean in a place where jobs are already so scarce that people struggle to make a living each and every day, like many parts?
I was coming to that. Because it comes to the interface between the digital economy and the bioeconomy. And the bioeconomy is that transition from the fossil fuel economy, where the African economies jump the era of iron and steel, an old form of industrialization, where we can rethink. And there's a colleague in Harvard called Calestus Juma, who's writing a lot about this digital economy and what it will mean for Africa in terms of how we reorganize economic activities in Africa. So the idea is, what is considered work and the meaning of work will have to be reconsidered in the future in Africa. In other words, what people do in Africa, when the colonialists came there, they thought people were lazy, because in African communities, when they have a palaver, which is resolving disputes, it could take a week. But we don't do that anymore. We have elections, and people come in, and we have election monitors, and we don't put money in the communities to clean up our communities, to educate people, and to think of new economies in the 21st century.
But in your work, you often rail against the depredations of capitalism.
Oh, I do. Right? I still do.
Yeah, you still do.
Yeah.
And you know, but I'm wondering, is there a social democratic solution
no.
to the problem? Because someone like Dambisa Moyo, the Zambian economist, says yeah. really the problem in Africa is that there's not enough capitalism.
Yeah, yeah. I am sorry, I would not agree with that.
Why?
Because
what's your solution?
First of all, capitalism was born in Africa. You know, any of you have been to Ghana, and you go to those forts in Cape Coast at the Elmina Castle, and you see the story of the birth of capitalism, you can see the tremendous horror story. So capitalism is not about capital, about money. Capital is a relationship of production and exploitation. So the problem is, how do we create a new relationship between human beings? And in Africa, we don't have a problem of money. Africa is the richest place on earth. The point is, all of that wealth for the past 300 years does not accrue to reconstituting the lives of the people of Africa. It goes outside of Africa. So our answer is, let us start with reimagining what the community would be like, what its African cities are going to be like. And one of the major challenges for us in Africa is that capitalism is destroying nature. The advance of the Sahara, the destruction of our communities, the destruction of rivers. In Ghana, they have something called artisanal mining. Artisanal mining is one of the main forms of employment in Ghana. It's called galamsey. So it is mining gold. What is the consequence of mining gold in this way in Ghana? The rivers are being killed. You cannot have a community if you don't have water. So if capitalism and having more capital means that you kill the water, then you will want to kill the people. So clearly, we have to rethink the nature of gold production in Ghana, government control of that gold production, and forms of economic activities. And this is where you come in, where Canadian gold mining companies cannot go into Ghana and mine gold the way they cannot do in Canada themselves. So this is where solidarity comes in terms of your work.
So I want you to be our Thomas More. Right?
And I don't know who Thomas More is.
The author of Utopia, right?
So I'm sorry, that reference doesn't...
No, but the author of Utopia, because I want you to kind of look forward and imagine what that future actually looks like in concrete terms. Like when you imagine that economic system that you think would serve the interests of the people,
okay.
How does it operate? What does it look like?
Well, it will operate the way we operated in Africa before. It's called social collectivism. And we envisage it. The first thing in Africa is that they introduce a foreign concept to Africa. This foreign concept is called private property. Just as they introduce it to Africans, they introduce it to North America. When they went to Chief Seattle in Washington State, and the Europeans came to him with this idea of buying and selling land, he says, "What is this? Buying and selling land? You mean you could actually sell land?" So we want to abolish that idea that you could buy and sell property, land, you can buy and sell water. This idea of privatization of nature is one of the first things we abolish. The next thing we want to abolish is the idea that medicine and knowledge about science could be in the hands of specialized individuals who use it for profit. So that if you have a new scare in Africa, called Ebola. And African governments don't know what to do because they don't have an infrastructure. So what the future we imagine in Africa takes care of the fundamental things: food, shelter, clothing, healthcare, and a decent environment. The transition to that is going to take a very long time. That is not going to come overnight. But the first step in that process is having political power in Africa. You know, we could not even have this conversation if we had not taken power in South Africa. So the Agenda 2063 of the African Union, of having one African government, one African currency, one African army, freedom of movement across the continent, I am envisaging that future when we have the communications in Africa that make it possible for Africans to believe in Africa for the Africans.
You've talked about you've emphasized a Pan-Africanism from below. Mm-hmm. Can you kind of elaborate on that?
Yeah. You're giving me very good questions. I like that. What is Pan-Africanism first? Pan-Africanism came from the enslaved African. And the enslaved African had an idea about their humanity which was richer than those who enslaved them. So that idea of Pan-Africanism at the ontological level manifested itself in songs, in dance, in storytelling, and sometimes breaks out in revolution.
Can you explain ontological?
That is your view about your humanity, your deep thinking about your spiritual essence of who you are, because the slave trade has dehumanized. So Pan-Africanism was about the sense that, no, you may be able to take our bodies, but you cannot take our soul. So that is the essence of Pan-Africanism, that these people who were pushed with a stamp of blackness, this new quality in the human history, were asserting themselves as human beings. Now that process, when it broke out at the state level, and the first important breakout was the most profound in the Haitian Revolution, that the leadership tried to take that and move in another direction. Let's fast forward 200 years from the Haitian Revolution. The Pan-African movement fertilized African independence. And it's not over, because I think I met someone in the elevator who was coming from Martinique, the home of Frantz Fanon. And Martinique does not yet have independence. Western Sahara. So Pan-Africanism speaks to people's independence. So when we celebrate Black History Month, we must remember the people of Puerto Rico, Martinique, Cayenne, Western Sahara. Now, since 1963, the African leadership embraced Pan-Africanism. And that leadership is what we call Pan-Africanism of the states. And that Pan-Africanism of the states is manifest in the African Union. That is, the governments come together and say they want African unity. But they say that, but on the ground, the South African government have legislation against Mozambicans, against Malawians, and we have the xenophobia. The Pan-Africanism from below is what is manifest in the slogan of Marcus Garvey, Africa for the Africans at home and abroad. Because Pan-Africans from below operates in Africa. I live in Ghana. And where I live in Ghana, there is a thing they call a border among the Ewe people. And this border was put there by the French and the British. But among the Ewe people, their traditional monuments and burial grounds and other artifacts where the people have relationship across these borders. It is like East Africa. The Maasai people do not recognize the border between Kenya and Tanzania. So for us, the Pan-Africanism from below is how do we make it real that the education, the transportation, the environment, the health system takes care of the African peoples. The best example I can tell you about Pan-Africans from below is Ebola crisis, because Ebola does not recognize the border between Sierra Leone and Liberia and Guinea. And so no African government can solve Ebola, global warming, or Bilharzia sets the fly in their own countries. You need continental shearing. And in terms of global warming, one of my friends is in the International Space Agency, and he said you should take pictures from space of the forest fires that are raging in Africa. So global warming is having a detrimental effect on Africa. And so the new Pan-Africanism below is how we have what is called the Pan-African Environmental Justice Movement. Wangari Maathai is actually one of the leaders behind this. And so one of the projects I'm promoting is called the Great Green Wall of Africa, where you build all across Africa, 7,000 kilometers, this great green wall, 15 kilometers wide, which was started by Thomas Sankara to stop the desertification in Africa. Mm-hmm. That's a future envisaged.
You present this idea, this notion of a single government for Africa by 2063 as being an objective, a goal, something to aspire to. Mm-hmm. But that idea for many leaves them with a lot of dread. And it's not something that they're necessarily as enthusiastic about, because they actually believe that governing themselves in their own kind of milieu is much more is certainly in the best interest of the. Let me frame it a little bit better. Is a much better way of managing the interests of their people than having a remote government in some far off place dictating to them how they're supposed to live their lives. Why are you so sanguine about this idea of a singular government in Africa?
I'm trying to get back to the earlier part of the question that about some people wanting local government. Hmm. Yeah, I don't know who those people are. I don't know where they are in Africa. Because there's no government in Africa. Nowhere in Africa where the Africans can make decisions about currency. And if you cannot make current decisions about currency, you cannot make a decision about your economic future. There's no African country that have a currency that's internationally recognized, that you have the French franc or the euro, the pound sterling, the Japanese yen, and the US dollar. And as long as Africa is dictated to, like there are 14 countries in Africa, they cannot make a decision about their fiscal future, because France and the euro makes that decision. And I made the point about the fact that one of the reasons why they went into Libya was because the African Union planned for an African currency. Whether we have an African government or not, Africa has to have a common currency or it will not have independence. You cannot. Canada has a level of independence from the United States because the Canadian currency is dictated by the Canadian government. Whether you're in Moncton or you're in Alberta, you have one currency in Africa. The South African rand or the Nigerian naira or the Kenya shilling is meaningless when you leave those countries. So yes, the African people in every part of Africa want that their resources, whether it is water, it is sunshine, or whether it is grass, that those resources come back to them in a form that their children can go to school. And the only way they can do that is when they have a government that can harness the resources. Now, you take...
So it's an economic union you're proposing in the form of like the EU?
Oh, no, it's beyond the EU.
Explain.
Because, you see, let me explain. This is not something new for Africa, because I think some of us have short memory. I'm glad you reference the fact that I've been this thing a long time. When I went to East Africa in 1972, in East Africa, they had something called the East African Community. In the East African Community, they had one currency, they had one airways, they had one post office, they had one university, and it was very stable. The British and the Europeans broke up the East African Community because it would be the harbinger of African cooperation. And the East African Community preceded the the European Union. So what Africans are fighting for was there before the European Union. The European Union does not want to have an African Union. The European Union, they're going around Africa, they call for something called the Economic Partnership Agreements. And these Economic Partnership Agreements, it's to tie Africa to European economies. Now, the British, and you know that Britain used to call itself Great Britain, and it's no longer great. But Britain, they have $1 trillion invested in African mining. And the London Mercantile Exchange, along with the City of London financial markets, depend for their sustenance on controlling African minerals. What we are looking for in Africa, we are looking for good relations with Europe. But we believe that if you have 6 major diamond centers in the world, which are Hong Kong, Antwerp, New York, India, none of those are Africa. But it is Africa from which they're getting most of these diamonds. So what we're talking about is not union, because I want to distinguish myself from those governments in Africa. What we're talking about is how it is that if you produce sugar or tea or cocoa beans in Ghana, why is the chocolate factory in Birmingham or in Belgium, that they're producing this great cocoa, and the conditions of the workers in the cocoa farms in Cote d'Ivoire and Nigeria, they don't have schools, they don't have housing, they don't have running water.
So you do want more capitalism?
No. We don't want more capitalism. We want better conditions for the people who produce wealth. So in the short run, it might be within some form of capital accumulation, but it is not some. Capitalism has no future in the world. In fact, what capitalism is doing, it is bringing the world to the precipice of war. And I shudder to think what is going to come out of this war. So no, we don't want more capitalism. If you look at a country like Ethiopia, one of the things Ethiopia has given to us in Africa is continuity. And I talk about African language. If you look at the Ethiopian university system and the education in Ethiopia, you'll see the seeds of what we're talking about. Because the Ethiopians have been able to harness their language for education. So that when people talk about the growth of Ethiopia, they don't talk about the base that is coming from, which is the language and culture and the continuity. And that's what I'm talking about, that we need in Africa for the transition for the kind of African unity. We're not going to have Ethiopia, because the problems between Ethiopia and Somalia and Eritrea and Sudan cannot be resolved within the borders of Berlin and what was introduced in Berlin. So we want something else. And that Ethiopia, His Majesty called for that. He called for...
His Majesty being Haile Selassie.
Yes, yeah. Rastafari, we came from that tradition of calling for African unity. And so we want that to be in all African societies. And many African leaders are afraid of the future that we are mapping out.
Someone that you hold in high regard and that you often reference in your work is C.L.R. James. C.L.R. James, of course, one of the leading intellectuals 20th century from Trinidad, author of the book Black Jacobins, many consider to be the definitive book on the Haitian Revolution, and who has the line, every cook can govern. I want you to tell us what you believe every cook can govern, what that phrase means when it comes to Africa.
I brought two of my books, Barack Obama, 21st Century Politics, here. And the last chapter is about that, about every cook can govern. because that is about returning to African democracy. You see, C.L.R. James came out of a movement in Europe that wanted to save Europe from fascism. But one of the genius of James, which most European Marxists never understood, and they still do not understand, is the relationship between race and class. And so even now, the left in North America do not understand this thing about black lives and reparations. So within the traditional left, you have no discussion about reparations. But James says, the race question cannot be separate from the class question. It is inseparable. And he has a very dialectical formulation to deal with this race and class question.
Can I just add something to that? Because one of his proteges, Bobby Hill, who you know very well, and he was actually here at this university, Carleton University, in the 1960s. Yes. He's been at UCLA for a long time.
Yeah, he's retired.
Retired now. But he would say that it's important for us to see the world through the lens of race, but we should never allow race to become our prison. We should see the world through the prism of race, but not allow it to become our prison. That's right. Just to add to that.
In other words, we must understand how the world has been reformulated in racial terms. And this is the lesson for the left today in dealing with Trump. And I'm going to diverge a bit because I really believe that we must, in a setting like this, as black people, express our solidarity with all of the peoples from those seven countries that are called Islamic countries who have the ban put on them by the government of the United States. And we read this ruling coming from Homeland Security. They want to have 100,000 a National Guard rounding up immigrants. We're entering a dangerous period. I would just want to diverge. Now, we cannot have Black History Month without talking about our solidarity with the Mexican people and all of the people who are immigrants. But to come back to Every Cook Can Govern, the limitation of James's formulation of Every Cook Can Govern, that James was drawing from Greek democracy. And the limitation of Greek democracy is that Greek democracy was for citizens. And Greece was a society of citizens and slaves. Every Cook Can Govern in our time is about everyone in the society. Men, women, workers, students, and we will not...
Gays, lesbians, transgender.
That is the point I'm coming to. That's the point I'm coming to, because within the Pan-African movement, and I'm somewhat of an outlier in the Pan-African movement, because there's so many of people I used to know who say they don't support Professor Campbell anymore because he does not support Robert Mugabe in Zimbabwe. And I say to them, I cannot support a leader who called gays and lesbians dogs and pigs. And I believe that in the Pan-African movement, we have to fight for the rights of all. And that's why Black Lives Matter is such an important movement, because it is transgender people who have taken the political leadership. And within the church, we have had this very conservative Christianity that has been going against people of a different sexuality. So Every Cook Can Govern is a formulation that ended my book. I have only two copies here, Barack Obama and 21st Century Politics, A Revolutionary Moment. Because I said the pseudo-democracy in the United States of America, which has been exposed now, because the United States system of democracy was based on racism in something called the Electoral College to preserve the rights of the slave masters in the South. And it has come back to haunt them. But the university system, the law school, the system does not have the intellectual resources to confront it, because they have to confront a past that they don't want to deal with. And this is one of the things that is good about this crisis of the current leadership in the United States of America. The liberal intelligence in the United States will have to confront its racist past, and they don't want to do that. Mm-hmm.
Just to add to that, and I think we'll end with this, because I think you were kind of going in that direction. What should Pan-Africanism, what should African liberation mean in the context of
a multiracial, multi-ethnic, pluralistic society.
Very good. Thank you. You're showing me these nice ones. Because in our Pan-African movement, there's a division. And I referenced my book on Libya. And the reason the Pan-African movement has not been so forceful about Libya is that there are some people who say that Pan-Africanism is about black people. And by saying Pan-Africanism is about black people, they have this category that they use in African studies. I don't know what it is, called sub-Saharan Africa. We never use that term. And whenever I hear an African academic use the term sub-Saharan Africa, I say, have you heard of the African Union?
Why do people use it?
It's a term that is used by the State Department of the United States because the United States State Department has North Africa as part of the Middle East. Mm-hmm. And so the university system have this thing called sub-Saharan Africa. I ask them, well, in sub-Saharan Africa, where are you going to cut off the Nile? You know, and so our project about Africa does not constitute this thing called sub-Saharan Africa. So within our Pan-African movement, there's a substantial part that says, no, these people they call Arabs from Tunisia, from Algeria, from Libya and Egypt and Sudan, they shall not be part of the movement. And these people they call Arabs, I say, well, what about the Berber people in North Africa? And so this is a debate. And so that's why I'm asking all of you, every one of you can come to Ghana, because we are trying to put forward a different view about Africa through global African education. Now, that is the Kwame Nkrumah position, which is also our position. But I am from the Caribbean. And one of the Pan-Africanists from the Caribbean is one of our great thinkers called Walter Rodney. And Walter Rodney said this about Pan-Africanism. He says, in every society where African people live, they live in multi-ethnic, multi-racial, multilingual societies. And so in his particular case in Guyana, where he lived, where half of the population were Indian workers, he said the Pan-Africanism of the African worker must be to lift the living standards of the Indian worker. He was killed for that. He was assassinated by the government for that. And we are working on a book. We had a commission of inquiry for 36 years to inquire into the killing of Walter Rodney. But there are some Africans in Guyana who will tell you that Walter Rodney had soloed to the Kuli people. Because he
was. What is Kuli?
It's a derogatory term in the Caribbean that refers to those peoples of Indian ancestry who were brought to the Caribbean as indentured laborers after the end of slavery. Mm-hmm. And so Walter Rodney had dedicated his life. And the last thing he was writing is the history of the Guyanese working peoples. And he was dedicating his life to show the conditions of their life. And in particular, he shows that in building Guyana, because Guyana had the main areas of plantation agriculture had to reclaim the land and to build polders and ponds, and how the Indian and African workers created that Guyana, and how Guyana must be returned to the people of Guyana, which is Indian African. Now, our Pan-Africanism is saying that in the United States of America, and I said it when we started here, we cannot talk about Pan-Africanism without paying our respects to the First Nation peoples. So we cannot be Pan-Africanism, we want black liberation, we want black freedom. Now, what about the people who they carried out genocide against? So the philosophical basis of the Pan-Africanism we support is one that embraces Walter Rodney's view about how to have multilingual, multi-ethnic, multiracial society, how we build a non-racial democracy. That's why I started out with the South African project of what a non-racial democracy will mean.
Horace Campbell, thank you very much.
Oh, Rastafari.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. So we have time for some questions. And I'm going to have to apologize because, unfortunately, I have another engagement and I'm going to have to leave in a couple of minutes. So I do apologize for checking out a little bit early. But if you have any questions.
You're going to leave me your DTS.
We will. We will. Okay. You can't bunk at my place this time around.
Okay.
No, you can't.
In your crisscrossings of the world, what has been the influence of the Chinese that you can talk about here tonight?
Yeah.
That's one question. The other one is that you said capitalism is on its way out. It won't survive. I'm not a mathematician, but can I make an equation based on what you're saying, having to do with the religious right and all that type of stuff, and people in religious circles, the ones who are against the gay, you know, do that kind of stuff, persuasion.
LBGT?
Yeah. People against that persuasion. I was listening to a program and came from the Caribbean, originated from the Caribbean, and some commentators said that, and pardon my expression, but this is what they said, I'm reporting what they said, that two women cannot penetrate each other. They said also that two men cannot propagate. Is capitalism, which is on its way out, on the same terms as the human race? What difficulties do you see down the road in those two areas?
Okay, let me take that one because it is of two part. You see, we're in the era of singularity. Rick Kurzweil has written this book called Singularity. And singularity is a moment in human history when humanity breaks out into transhumans. We have reached the point where we will not have to have sex to reproduce human beings. So that becomes a moot question. It becomes a moot question because the reproduction of the human species will not be depending solely on sexual relations between humans. We're already there. The question of the rights of people of a different sexual persuasion is something we have to fight about. And we have to speak about it, and we cannot be we cannot be mealy-mouthed about it. Because it is a situation where if a leader says you should kill gays and lesbians, what is next? If you think you can kill gays and lesbians like dogs, why can't you kill other human beings like they did in Rwanda in genocidal violence? So we should not open the door to any kind of discrimination against people for any. And so the Christian right wing, which is actually carrying out a counter-revolution in Africa. Because this Christian right wing that I see, and I see students in Ghana praying every day, and I ask them, this Christianity you're following, is it the Christianity of Martin Luther King, or Mother Teresa, or Pope Francis, or is it the Christianity of Donald Trump? And the right wing in the United States of America. Because I started out my presentation and talk about the Rastafari. Jesus believed in sharing. Jesus was a socialist. Jesus believed that everybody should have food, and he broke bread, and he broke wine so that everybody could eat. I believe those principles should be brought back to the center of Christianity. Ananias and Sapphira was driven out because they wanted to accumulate wealth. And the church today is supporting what they call prosperity Christianity. It's part of the counter-revolutionary period that we're in.
You want to comment on the overturning of the tables in the temple?
Precisely. That's the same thing. You know, if Jesus was alive and around, he would be against the IMF and the World Bank. That's what he did when he threw out the temple. Now, about the Chinese in Africa, they are a new kid on the block. the one good thing about the China in Africa is that they have made sure that Africans have choices. But because they're so new in Africa, they really don't understand the terrain they're in. They don't understand the nature of British imperialism. Let me give you one example. There is the man called Schwarzman went to the Chinese to say that they should set up a Cecil Rhodes-type scholarship at the University of Tsinghua.
Who's Schwarzman?
Schwarzman is one of the biggest capitalists on Wall Street, and he gave $300 million to the Chinese to do. He's actually one of the, no, the advisors. What is his? Blackstone?
Okay.
One of those companies. Now, because the Chinese don't know who Cecil Rhodes is, they thought this was to advance education. And I said to them, you are going to be fought by Africans because you know who Cecil Rhodes is? Cecil Rhodes was a person who plundered Africa. So the Chinese are in Africa, and there are three kinds of Chinese in Africa. There are the Chinese government, there's Chinese state corporations, and there's private individuals that are in Africa. Now, when you have a small Chinese capitalist, in Chinese terms, let's say that person has $20 million. In China, that's a small capitalist. But such a person in Ghana can command a lot of resources and works with Ghanaians to destroy the environment in Ghana. So we're saying to the Chinese government, the legislation that you have in China against illegal mining, you must enforce that in Africa in relationship to your nationals who are helping to destroy the environment in Africa.
Also, they're undercutting African workers, because I think even in the case of Ghana, there was the building of the stadia, mm-hmm. I believe, that were, I think as part of the contract, the project had to only hire Chinese workers. And so a lot of Ghanaian workers were left out of the mix.
Okay. And again, this is where I believe Africans have a lot to teach the Chinese. I believe the relationship with the Chinese and Africa is going to be great. African workers have a level of autonomy that Chinese workers do not have. Brent mentioned Nigerian workers. Chinese workers don't have that.
Okay.
And I believe Chinese workers will learn from African workers in the process.
Okay.
Fascinating. Lots of food for thought. I have a comment, and it's really around education and awareness. And you talked about literacy, and a big part of this for me is, you know, awareness precedes change. You've got you sound 2063 in terms of goal and objective. I'm wondering, for me, this conversation around how do you educate in order to mobilize, because it's a gathering storm. You talked about the value chain, quite a few kind of imperatives between now and 2063. Here in Canada, there was a report, I think in about 2006, about the business case for diversity, right? And my question is going, to what extent is there this business case for an African union 2063 or whatever date into the future? There's quite a bit of conversation. I follow a Teresa Clark who talk about the diaspora divide and the notion of, you know, still in that business case, professor, that you own 60, you talked about the land, the water, the sun, the diamonds, 64% of the world's diamonds, a billion people, including the diaspora, 100 African folks in Brazil, in the Caribbean, in the United States. We have, there in 2017, we have a lot of advocates for understanding how do we get that to make the business case to support what you're talking about, which really for me says, not so much from the woe is me Africa, but this is how we speak in that value chain you talk about. When you relate it to the IMF. And I wonder if you can elaborate whether that's in the story, the business case for arriving, for Pan-Africanists or African folks in the diaspora or in Africa, to talk a little more about that, because that has some resonance to some of us, the yep. business case around that.
Okay.
Thank you.
The business case is undeniable. In fact, one of the things I'm going to be doing is talking to business schools in Africa, because we need African entrepreneurs. We need people with the knowledge of how to turn African wealth into schools and into housing for the peoples of Africa. But so far, a lot of the African entrepreneurs have no confidence in Africa. And so we need to create the climate where if you're a business person in the Congo, there's no need for you to keep your money in London or France or so forth. But I don't believe that African government should sell razor blades or should sell tomatoes, or that there's a place which we have for history. For 500 years, Africans had traders and business people. When Mansa Musa went to Mecca and he traveled with that convoy of gold, okay, in the 14th century, and the price of gold dropped for 20 years. We were talking about African business people in those times. So there is a place for African business persons, but we want patriotic African business persons.
Baba Mkubwa, tunashukuru sana umekaribishwa kwetu. Thank you.
Tumeshukuru vile vile.
But I'm a little bit perturbed by how far 2063 is. What is the point of a 2063 agenda? Why not 2022 or 2025? Is it more another neoliberal document that's just full of declarations, but that is not, you know, is going to become a protracted process, especially in the case where China built the AU headquarters, or Kenya? No one has taken a position on Kenya bombing Somalia, if I'm not mistaken. So in some...
I have.
Perfect. So in some, why 2063? Okay. What's the point? We're in 2017. Thank you.
What I would like to raise is about the, to know your views or to share your views on the building blocks of Pan-Africanism in Africa. We talked about the African Union. 50 plus years we've been working on to have the African Union working towards the 2063 agenda. When I say the building blocks, I'm talking about the regional corporations. You mentioned about the East African Corporation. And within different African states, the reality is that it's multilingual, multi-ethnic. It's so diverse, Africa. And African countries are so diverse. You've mentioned about the case of Ethiopia. It's about 80 plus ethnic groups in Ethiopia with 80 plus languages. And to address that, governments and have talked about grassroots recognition of these different ethnic groups, recognition of identity. Identity politics still plays a big part in our politics, and that has been, you cannot ignore it. What we did in Ethiopia is just give it due recognition so that in the transaction, we aspire to build unity in diversity. And these are the little grassroots building blocks that leads us towards the greater unity of Africa. I just wanted to share your thoughts on that.
Kwanza, inataka kusema, ambayo hii mambo inatoka mbali sana. Alafu, wewe ni kazi yako kujenga Afrika. Alafu minarudisha mswali kwa wewe. Okay. I'm telling her that this question of Agenda 2063, that she is the one that has to shape it. Because the question she's asking me reminded me of the criticism that used to be made about the OAU. There was something called the Organization of African Unity. And they used to say to us, back then, why are you part of the OAU? You have Kenyatta, you have Moi, you have Mobutu. It is a club of African dictators. So why would you want to be part of the OAU? And we said, the OAU was a compromise that was created out of the Pan-African movement and our job is to push it to its logical conclusion. And we had a little part of it. What was our little part of it? It was called the OAU Liberation Committee. And from the OAU Liberation Committee, the Pan-Africanists supported the movement against apartheid in Southern Africa. So the point I'm making to this generation is that, yes, we are very aware of all of the limitations of the AU. We did not put 2063 as our goal. We put 2007. And we called a meeting in 2007, and we had one item on the agenda. Well, the African governments undermined that. And those governments had support from what they call their partners. And their partners are France, the European Union, and so forth. So to come back to your question, we support Agenda 2063 because we support a moment in history where we say we must have African unity. In my inaugural address last week, I referred, Kwame Nkrumah said, in 1963, unite or perish. I think we are still there, but it is becoming clearer. The currency crisis, the trade crisis, the financial crisis, the environmental crisis, all of this means that we have to do our work together. I'm coming back to African studies here. I referenced the way in which the foundation spent $1 billion to change the discussion about African unity. I do not see African studies centers internationally embracing Agenda 2063 or having research projects. I spent about 2 hours this morning talking to Professor Clark here about the African court and about how you prosecute peoples for financial crimes in Africa. We don't see business schools involved in these questions about illicit financial flows out of Africa. We have a commission of inquiry headed by Thabo Mbeki. We have the findings that $50 billion goes out of Africa every year. But our business schools in Africa or overseas do not engage this. So yes, we can critique the African government. Well, what is our role? That was the first question about the AU. And I'm glad you raised the question of Palestine, because now Morocco is back in the African Union, and Morocco wants them to throw out the Western Sahara. So we have to be as vigilant as we were in the past. Religion and the Pan-African Union. Where is this young man who asked the question? Yeah. Agenda 2063 is working for a prosperous, peaceful, and strong Africa. In my work on African Union, I'm adding something else. I'm adding that we want a secular Africa. Because is that secularism in Africa that allowed Africa to be stable for 10,000 years? The two new religions in Africa, Christianity and Islam, these two new religions have arrogated to themselves the right to call African religions primitive. So actually, Africa is a multi-religious continent. These religions are actually minority religions. Most African peoples are following an African religion. And even when someone tells you that they're Christian in Ghana, and they might tell you they're Christian, when they go home, they are worshiping some African ancestor. So African religion is still very much alive. So when we call for a secular Africa, we are also calling for recognition of African religions. About the building blocks of Africa and languages. One of the things that I believe strongly about is the rehabilitation of African languages. My partner, she did her work on African languages as language of instruction. And that's why I salute the Ethiopians, because the Ethiopians are very clear that their independence over the centuries is linked to their language. And the Ethiopian university is based on reproducing in African languages. So what are the building blocks? I go back to Albert Einstein. Einstein on the importance of diversity. And out of our collective diversities, we have unities. So the challenge in Africa is how to celebrate that diversity and not to explain. In other words, the fact that in Ethiopia, we have people who are Amharic, Oromo, Somali, and so forth, should be a source of strength for the society and not a source of division. But what happened in Africa, we have something called democracy, where democracy is based on ethnic majorities and it's based on voting. And I believe, for me, the democracy in Africa, I believe that running water is the most democratic question in Africa, or providing electricity. So we're promoting a new kind of democracy. The building blocks for African unity is there among the African peoples. And in a case like Ethiopia, the demilitarization of the Ethiopian society is very central for democracy, because we cannot solve the question of Eritrea or Oromo or Somalia militarily. We have to find another way. And so I'm talking about demilitarization in Africa is very important. I hope I answered your question. Yeah.
I come from Congo, and
which one?
The Democratic Republic of Congo. And every time I come back, it just blows my mind that there's no engineering studies in university. And you're a professor of university. And it blows my mind because we complain that we don't have factories to refine our minerals. We don't have engineers that will work to refine the minerals, so the minerals will never be refined. So we have to send it overseas. We complain that the sanitation system sucks, but we don't have the engineers to conceive of a sanitation system, right? There's no engineering studies in the Congo. I was wondering, are there any initiative in Ghana or anywhere in Africa that trains engineers to build the country, to build a continent?
I want to go back when you started your conversation with Adrian. He asked you to redefine unity in a more modern context. We're talking about climate change, AI, Mr. Trump. What I want to ask, what does African unity mean in terms of bridging the rural and the urban divide? Because you've talked a lot about not market forces, but rather a state making sure that African wealth reaccrues to Africa. Well, Africa's a lot bigger than it looks on a map. It's a big place. So where does that wealth go to? I feel like Accra and the Sahel will disagree. And I hope you can clear that up.
Thank you.
The wall along the Mexican border, if the Mexicans were law-abiding citizens, why are there so many gated communities in Mexico to protect Mexicans from unsavory Mexican citizens? The second thing is the trade deficit with China is about $250 billion a year in favor of China. If it weren't for the United States bringing technology to China, China will still be striving for a bicycle, a radio, a watch, and a sewing machine. So it's not fair to criticize America for what Trump wants to do. The last one I want to ask you about is Islam. It's not Muslims that are the problem, it's Islam itself and its clash with Western kind of psyche. American psyche is rooted in the soil of freedom, in the soil of life, in the soil of the pursuit of happiness. Whereas Islam is a religion that insists that it's a monotheistic, which means that all Hindus, like myself, are infidels, basically. And it also insists that it is a submission to Allah, an unknown quantity, and to his prophet, Muhammad, a human being. And he is the chief and final one. You see the clash? The clash is actually intellectual. These two are completely at opposite ends. So if Trump is afraid of Islam, it's not Muslims that he's afraid of, he's afraid of the culture of Islam. Could you please elaborate what you think about these points? Thank you.
But I want to know, in 2063, is the template for the One Africa, is it the same template from Muammar Gaddafi with the United States of Africa, or is it its own different template and its own different ideology? Second, do you see Arabs assimilating or accepting that new Africa in 2063? What would back the dollar when they have the new currency? Would it be gold that backs the dollar? And how would the government be set up? How would we run? Would we go back? Would we use a Eurocentric model as far as having prime ministers or presidents, or would we go to king or emperors, or how would the United States, or how would the One Africa be set up and run?
And you rightly mentioned that they strengthen diversity, but my experience as a Kenyan has been the weakness of that diversity. And you talked about, you know, building Pan-Africanism from the ground, the micro project. And so there is 2063 at a state level. But how are we going to build that localized spaces of solidarity so that we can, because I believe the 2063 project, its success will very much depend on how much we as Africans really embrace the idea of Pan-Africanism at a very individual and local level. So how are we going to build that internal and local project? Thank you.
Greetings, brother. My question essentially, it touches on your point about us entering, and I think Adrian raised it, an inflection point, which is the moment where, because of artificial intelligence, the financial and other various crises of the day, as well as, you called it, I guess, a bio-economy moment. We're at this inflection point, and most forecasters are anticipating that much of this transition, this transformation, is going to happen within the next 10 to 20 years. So coming back to this point about Agenda 2063, we have so many challenges in Africa. We have a youth bulge. We have the expected doubling of the population by 2050, massive urbanization. How do we mobilize? How do we, we don't have the luxury of 2063 to really solve or respond to these challenges. And so the solution would be to really mobilize what you call Pan-Africanism from the ground up. But what is the infrastructure? Is the African Union or putting the infrastructure in place to really achieve this massive mobilization of the energies of people to solve these problems, or is it all institutional?
The question you're asking me presupposes that you have no responsibility in the process, that you are outside of it, that you're talking about something that's happening someplace. I'm going to ask you, what is your role?
You want an answer?
Of course!
I thought it was a rhetorical
question. No!
Well, to be quite honest, last year, I worked for the public service. Last year, I contacted the government of Senegal to take 1 month of my vacation and go and plant trees as part of the Great Green Wall Project. And you wouldn't believe they turned me down. And I'm a public servant. I work for the foreign ministry. And they were like, no, I'm sorry, we cannot take your free service and, we cannot take your help.
Okay, thank you. Thank you. You answered my question. Mm-hmm. The point is, you see yourself as part of the process. Yep. That's what I wanted to know. This African Union that we are talking about have nothing to do with governments. The African Union will not be built by governments. In fact, the African governments are afraid of the African Union. The reason they support it is because it has reached a stage that they have to embrace it to try to control it. Now, where did the African Union come from? Did it come from Gaddafi? Where did it come from? You ever heard of a man called Marcus Garvey? The African Union predates Gaddafi. It predates Kwame Nkrumah. But the point is, Marcus Garvey recognized in 1919 that if you're fighting against the Ku Klux Klan in South Carolina, you have to have an African power that can back you up. And we recognize that then, that Africa must be free for black people to be free everywhere, that we support the African Union, not because we support the government of Kenya or the government of Nigeria or the government of Senegal. In everything they do, the government of Kenya will organize the killing of Kenyans and then try to mobilize all of Africans in its support for killing its own citizens, and they expect the African Union to go along with that. It's a travesty. So we, from the progressive wing of the Pan-African movement, we have to oppose that. I think we have had a lot of questions. There was a question about Trump and the digital era, and somebody about Islam. Your question is very dangerous. Very, very dangerous. Because you're identifying a religion and a people with something that is evil. And that's the basis for war. I would urge you, if you follow any kind of religion, that religion is about bringing people together. Religion is to solve what people don't understand in the relations between humans and nature. So it solves the problem of the relation between humans and nature and between humans and humans. The language that you've used about Islam and the followers of Islam is the basis for mobilizing people on differences. And what we want to do is we want our differences to enrich us. Whether you're a Muslim or Hindu or Christian or Buddhist, I think that the world is big enough for all of us to live in it and share. At the basis of all of this, since the 15th century, is the idea of Europeans putting themselves on top. And Trump and the white supremacists have made that clear. So this thing about Islam is one way of reproducing white supremacy. And in a meeting of Black History Month, where we have suffered from this white supremacy, we cannot, in any meeting in Black History Month, support the ideas that you're putting forward. So I'm hoping that you would be educated and be humbled by this setting to say is something you need to learn, because the person Donald Trump is very dangerous for the citizens of the United States of America and for the citizens of Canada and for the citizens of Mexico. Let me go to the question about the young man. I think I've answered. There was a question I didn't answer about.
Well, my talking about Trump was just rhetorical. What I really want to know about is how will one Africa bridge the divide between rural and urban?
Good. Okay, the rural-urban divide.
Yes.
This man here is from Africa.
Yes.
And when you meet them, you find them in some urban communities. And even if they live there for 100 years, at a certain time of the year, you hear them say they're going home. let me finish.
I will.
Yeah. And by home, they meant the ancestral home, the village, and the strength of the village community, and harnessing the positive elements of the village community for the 21st century is a very important aspect of African unity. The urbanization that we've seen in Africa is actually destruction, because we do not have planned urbanization in Africa. If you look at Nigeria and you see what is called slums, and you see the privatization of refuse collection, they do not have any planned system in Africa. So what we need in Africa is planning at every level. So we will take up those questions privately afterwards. Exactly.
I need to thank the Office of the Dean of the Faculty of Arts and Social Sciences, the Office of the Provost and Vice President Research, the President of CU for her continued support, of Carleton University, for her continued support of the Institute of African Studies that has been unwavering. And last but not least, we need to thank our keynote for taking the time to be here with us, Adrian Harewood, who continues to give so generously of his time to the community, to the Departmental Administrator of the Institute of African Studies, June Payne, who is always behind the scenes and hiding somewhere in here because she doesn't want to be pointed out, and of course, the Director of the Institute of African Studies, Pius Adesanmi, for his leadership vision and the continued support of African studies at Carleton University.